Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the City Club of Portland. Almost 64 years ago, on April 23, 1923, Governor Walter Pierce spoke to a meeting of this organization, beginning a tradition that has included almost every governor since then. We are honored at the City Club to continue that tradition this afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, the governor of the state of Oregon, Neil Goldschmidt.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It is nice to be back. It is nice to be back here, and I appreciate your reception. Will Rogers once said that everything is funny as long as it's happening to somebody else. Actually, this job is funny to me a good part of the time, but apparently it doesn't always show on my face. Recently, we received a letter from an Astoria citizen who is suspicious of the governor because, quote, he always looks like he is about to cry. He even enclosed a sample bill for introduction to the legislature that would require all public officials to put on a happy face. He felt that passage of such legislation would protect Oregon from dangerous human elements. But I must have made a good impression on three students from Sam's Valley School in Central Point. They wrote on behalf of their class to thank me for spending time with them last November. In closing, they said, "You are the nicest governor we have ever met." They did go on to say that you are also the only governor we have ever met. We are getting perhaps the best mail in the governor's office of all the mail we get about the Department of Motor Vehicles express offices. One writer even asked if the Department of Motor Vehicles could take over the U.S. Postal Service. Lines and waits are down to next to nothing, and correspondents feel really good about how personable and helpful the state staff are to them. And I must say all of that's really nice, but when I went to the new Mall 205 Express office to get myself a new license to comply with the change of address requirement, the clerk wouldn't issue it to me because I didn't have two pieces of ID proving who I say I am and that I live where I say I live. It is sure wonderful to be the head of something again. It is great to be the governor of Oregon. I'm happy about the state of the state as we enter a new year. 1987 was a fantastic year for Oregon, and you should all congratulate yourselves. Terrific job. As those who have been visited by such a speech as this know, it is customary in a state of the state address for the governor to recite a laundry list of accomplishments from the past, followed by a wish list for the future. I intend to do neither today, and instead would like to talk about who we are as Oregonians and where this, our state, is headed in the final years of this decade. In my first year as governor, I traveled a great deal across this land that we love so much, and my conviction that Oregon is a unique place on earth, a place to be treasured and protected, has deepened. The stories we tell ourselves and others about who we are begin with the land and how we feel about it. The land fills our senses, its gifts sustain us, it touches our deepest spiritual beliefs, it connects us with the history of our planet and the human race's journey upon it. Tom McCall once said, "It is the place of Oregon that means the most. We must first and foremost cherish the place. All other good things will follow if we recognize the special beauty of Oregon first in all our planning, if we revere the magic, if we protect the quality." How deeply we believe those words, how honestly we have lived them, yet they are incomplete. All good things will not necessarily follow unless we recognize the human face in the landscape. Unless we revere those who give of themselves, unless we protect the dispossessed. Our measure of ourselves reaches high, elevated not only by standards of extraordinary personal example and achievement, but by our traditions of independence, of neighborliness, and caring that can be found in every part of Oregon and among every age group of our citizenry. Oregon is better for loaves and fishes, and for every volunteer and government effort we are making together to keep our elders, our parents, out of nursing homes, living lives of independence and dignity in their own homes. Oregon is better off because more of our mentally retarded citizens can find the humane care that helps them reach their full potential in their own communities. Oregon is better off when children are born healthy and will grow strong and independent because we cared enough that they have prenatal care. Oregon is better off when Oregonians make it so. People like Esther McGinnis, volunteer and founder of Loaves and Fishes Southwest Center. Esther has been a Meals on Wheels driver for 15 years. Make that 2 wheels, because Esther makes her deliveries on a Honda Twin Star motorcycle. 60 meals delivered each day to people's homes, more than 9,000 meals in her career. Esther not only helps the elderly stay in their own homes, she fights for their rights. And in fact, when I was mayor, Esther marched on City Hall to make sure that transportation services for seniors were protected. I'd like you to meet and greet her now. Esther, stand, please. People like the Reverend John Jackson, an outstanding leader in the Albina Ministerial Alliance in Northeast Portland for over 20 years. And now he is bringing his enormous generosity of spirit to bear on putting together a new initiative, an innovative new program for kids, one that will develop community support systems to help minority youth in foster care find permanent homes. This is a man who has devoted his life to fighting for human rights and human dignity, our friend, John Jackson. John? People like Dave Ohm. Dave is the assistant vice principal at Roseburg High School. He works with the Gateways Program for Alcohol and Drug Abuse in Roseburg. And when I visited there, I talked with kids who had smoked marijuana daily, children who were addicted to crack and methamphetamine, who had dealt drugs to support their habit. But they had turned their lives around through this program. And I asked them, each one of them, what was it that made you want to accept or be willing to accept help? And to a person, boys and girls alike, they all gave me the same answer, Dave Ohm. He dragged them into the program and he stayed by their side. He was the one who let them know there is a place for them in this life in Oregon. Greet Dave Ohm. People like Esther McGinnis and Reverend John Jackson and Vice Principal Dave Ohm are Oregon. It is here, more than any other place, where an individual effort can move a community or a state, where common conviction and community action can shape the future. If indeed that is true of this place called Oregon, it is only because of these people called Oregonians. You will hear me say this again and again, for I believe it now more than any time since I was born here. We are Oregon. When we were in danger of losing part of our natural heritage, we declared the beaches to be public property. When we were in danger of drowning in a sea of litter, we passed the bottle bill. When uncontrolled growth was threatening to swallow up our farmlands, we adopted land use legislation. And when the Willamette River was turning into an open cesspool, we cleaned it up. Time and time again, throughout our history, Oregonians have risen to the challenge. We have been good stewards of the land. And now it is time for this generation of Oregonians to meet our challenge to become stewards of the child. That we guarantee to every child in every region of our state a greater chance for a decent life. A life defined by healthy minds and bodies and by the dignity that comes from providing for oneself. As carefully as we have used and preserved, as passionately as we have cared about our forests, so must we husband and harvest the new growth of talent and hope that lies within the next generation. If for no other reason, it is in our self-interest. Who will be prepared for the highly technical jobs of tomorrow that are replacing the labor-intensive jobs of yesterday? Who will pay the taxes to support the special needs of those who are 75 years of age and older, a population group that is growing 12 times as fast as the general population? Who will teach and preach, invent and serve? Who will craft and compose? Who will lead and follow, defend and honor our nation, our children? And we must prepare them through education. Oregon's history reflects our deep commitment to learning. America's first Western College, Willamette University, was founded in Oregon in 1842. In 1849, 10 years before statehood, the territorial legislature set up a free system of public schools, created a common school fund, and levied a tax for the support of the common schools. The ladder was there, and for those dogged enough to climb it, education was the path of progress. We owe it to ourselves and to generations in the future to ensure that the ladder is secure and that it reaches as high as the most talented and gifted those among us can climb. It is not within our power to predict who will climb high to create the ideas that in fact create the new jobs, but it is within our power to ensure every child in every region of this state has a chance to go as far as they can. If this aspiration is to be fulfilled, we must remove every possible obstacle, not the least of which is financial, the financial stability of our K-12 schools. By this summer's end, we will have from our Citizens School Finance Commission proposals to achieve much of this goal. But as difficult as school finance has been, our children face a greater assault on their hopes, their skills, and best instincts. A 1985 study found that Oregon students experiment more at an earlier age with drugs than students nationally. Children who should find escape in books and on forest trails and beaches are too often finding escape in drugs. And if we choose to save the expense of helping them now, are we avoiding real costs? No. Pay now or pay later for the consequences of crime or mental disorders. A study in Oregon on the background of adult felons tried to find a single common denominator that might explain their antisocial behavior. Two-thirds had been abused as children. Child abuse is the single most powerful predictor of adult criminal behavior. And last year, there were almost 14,000 reported victims of child abuse in Oregon. Our prisons are overflowing with the products of drugs and abuse. We will build more prison cells because they are needed. But if this is all we do, they will always be full. The proportion of Oregon males under the supervision of the Corrections Division in 1973 was 1 in 87. Let me repeat that, 1 in 87. And in 1985, it is 1 in 40. In the year 2000, if the present trends continue, it will be 1 in 20. Can there be any greater delusion than placing all of our faith in more prison cells and in rehabilitating young adult criminals while leaving their younger brothers and sisters illiterate, homeless, abused, possibly drug addicted, and destined to join them in our institutions? (Clears throat) We are in a war for the hearts and minds of our kids. It is not a war that we can win with weapons of selfishness and misguided rhetoric about the limits of government. Our victory will be determined by how well we invest, as much as by the amount we invest. The student retention initiative of your state government is not about state spending, for its budget is actually relatively small. It is about making possible for communities to reach out to youngsters who need help. It's about standing up and saying that it is wrong to waste our young people's lives by doing nothing to help them stay in school. The initiative's goal of 90% of entering primary students graduating from high school or otherwise being properly placed is the most remarkable effort made across school, social service, local government, and state government boundaries in our recent history. Fighting child abuse and drug addiction is not about state spending. It's about saving kids' lives and stopping the rising spiral of crime that is draining our resources and sapping our spirit. I said earlier that the story of who we are begins with the land, but the story does not end there. It ends with the people of Oregon, people of quality, strengthened by community, enriched by the notion that caring for one's neighbor is as essential to living the good life as clean air and running streams. We are Oregon. Let this be our guide for the present and our vision for the future. It is the reason that we will fix school finance and get on with the exciting agenda of educational excellence. It is why we will no longer condemn the mentally ill to wander homeless on the streets of our cities. It is why we will reach into our... It is why we will reach into our university system and raise up to the world, to worldview, those parts and programs that can be truly great and can draw to Oregon further greatness. It is why we pursue regional economic strategies, not for giving out the little state money available, but to empower Oregonians, wherever they live, to find common purpose and, through common purpose, to lift themselves. We do it because it is fair. It is why we clean up poorly conceived and badly managed workers' compensation and veterans' loan programs, not to turn our back on the injured or those who served our country, but because badly run programs eat resources that belong to the beneficiaries and erode public confidence in the legitimate public mission. It is why we see in our past what our parents knew, that our future will always be in our children. All of this challenges us to set lofty goals, to come together in truly remarkable efforts. There is time before us to explore those efforts. There is room for all, everyone in Oregon, to join in shaping this endeavor. I will have more to say when I convene in February a meeting of all of the people who serve on Oregon's citizen boards and commissions. In February and in the months to come, I will be talking more about crime, education, and a children's agenda. But for today, it is enough that we look at Oregon and we see ourselves. It is enough that we take to heart this essential. It is not the setting in which we live. It is the life we give to that setting which distinguishes us. Out of this conviction, out of the bonds forged by coming together to build a better life for us all, a stronger Oregon will emerge. An Oregon that one day with pride we will bequeath to our children. And in their time and in their season, they will be able to look back on us and say, we are the sons and daughters of giants. Thank you.
First question. Thanks for those upbeat remarks. They were just wonderful. We keep hearing a lot, particularly in the Portland business community, Neil, about all kinds of problems with our business climate. I'd like to hear your personal evaluation of what you think of our business climate and what, if anything, needs to be done about it.
I think the most important thing that can happen for all of us is that when you, in this room, and those who are anyplace else in Oregon, are traveling here or outside of the state, and somebody asks you, how are things in Oregon, you can say, tremendous. And you give some sense of the capacity of Oregonians to move the things that concern them the most in the directions they must go, much of it done by people just simply working together. And I think it is happening now, and I want to answer you with a story that I think makes the point. This is not a story about how now the state of Washington cannot deduct their sales taxes paid on their federal income taxes and all the competitive stuff that is sort of the daily churning of selling Oregon. This is a story about what Oregonians did and what happened after we lost. The Portland Development Commission staff, a good crew of folks from Washington County, with a little bit of help from the state government and a lot of help from some lone business people, put together a proposal to attract the research consortium known as Semitech to your state. They had gone to the federal government to get $100 million to start this research effort along with all of their own funds, and they succeeded. And the other day in a hotel in Dallas, Texas, they decided that they would select Austin, Texas as the location. Within 48 hours of this private meeting at which the chief executive officers of all of the participating semiconductors were in attendance, the first client for the state of Oregon came here directly. And what they said was, we heard enough about you and about what you're doing together to get this state moving to tell us this could be a terrific place for us to have a business. They didn't come and talk to us about our problems, which we discovered plenty of in the process of this competition. They came to tell us what they heard from the site selection team. These people kept every promise they made, they kept every confidence of our personal business, and they worked together phenomenally well. They're proud of their state. Their education system is much better than we realized. They have a few deficiencies in critical areas for us, but we think they were good enough to rank very close to the top. That story, as it travels for us, is all you need to know about the Oregon business climate, or frankly, all you need to know about the Oregon climate. I was proud of all the folks who did the work, of all of the people who pitched in, and they're literally numbered in the hundreds. And I think you can find those efforts in every corner of the state today to take the future in people's hands to try to make their communities a healthier place to live. It's what made 1987 a great year, and I think it is what will take us where we have to go over the next decade. Next question. No more questions. Thank you very much. No.
This may be the most accessible governor we've ever had in the state of Oregon, and because he does respond to public questions so often,
there are none left.
There are none left, but yes. We have two microphones set up, and I urge you to come forward and give him a hard one.
Okay. Don Sterling, a member.
Don, Charlie will be answering this question, so.
He's my lawyer. Oh. Neil, who's going to be running higher education from here on, and to the extent that you have something to do with it, what do you want to accomplish with it?
Well, I assume the board and the chancellor will, and I take the business of higher I take the business of higher education seriously enough to treat it by the same set of standards I treat everybody else. Higher education may be uncomfortable about it in some ways, but it's time they got adjusted to the reality. We are not going to have a legislative proposal going to the next legislature that is essentially their creature and their creature alone. It's going to be an Oregon creature. We're going to have communities and citizens around this state involved in higher education as they have been, clear to the conclusion of a strategy not for one session, but for the next decade. The bloody problem for us to deal with is if you took the two most mature, large universities in this state, put them together, and asked yourself, program by program, whether they are as good or better than the people against which we say we're going to compete in Seattle, in Berkeley, in Los Angeles, in Wisconsin, in Minnesota, you name it, public universities, the answer is not yet. That doesn't get to Portland State or the other schools. And we are going to have to get there. We must get there. Every visiting person who comes to talk to us about an economy that is driven by intellect wants to talk about this. And we must put in place at the board level, at the chancellor level, and in the institutions, the resources to achieve this. And it isn't a money issue alone, because any time I ask the question of somebody on one of these campuses, what will it do to deal with the discipline that we have to win this battle? The answer is money. And it isn't just money. A rising tide large enough to float all of the ships, basically, on all of those campuses to a nationally competitive level is an economy we don't have today in Oregon. And I think it is possible by selecting targets, as the board has done in centers of excellence, and pursuing that through some additional agendas, that we can do a great deal more. I think higher education is an asset that all of us feel good about from our own personal experience. But unfortunately, it is a resource that the legislature feels mostly frustrated by. And that isn't good enough. And we have to do better. My start at promising to do better is that I am not going to accept the state system budget in a lump sum. I am starting this month to go through every single budget in the state system of higher education, campus by campus, so that I can understand what it takes to build one of these institutions, and I can become a lobby on behalf of excellence at the legislature. We're going to need everybody to participate, but if anybody misreads the actions of recent that this governor wants to be the board or wants to be the chancellor, don't. But if you do read into it that I have the same sense of commitment to higher ed that I have to the Department of Veterans Affairs or to fixing workers' compensation or making sure we pass a safety net and keep the schools open or pass a school finance program for K through 12 or doing something about this bloody crime problem, you have it figured out correctly.
Governor Mimi Bushman, City Club member. With the stated interest of white supremacist groups in moving to Oregon and the recent racial incidents at a Benson-Roseburg football game, what can the governor do to deal with this increase in activity of white supremacist groups and the growing threat?
Well, let me say that I'm a little uncomfortable with you mentioning white supremacist groups and the Roseburg-Benson game in the same breath. I am prepared to talk about racism as a problem in the state, including the problems that occurred in Roseburg. We have a little bit of a peculiar structure in state government. We have a commission on Hispanic affairs. We have one on black affairs. We have one on women's affairs. We have one on child care. But we don't have what the city of Portland and Multnomah County have had for years in the Metropolitan Commission on Human Relations. For more years than most people in this room will remember, back way before I became an active public participant, this commission has interceded wherever it needed to, much to the discomfort occasionally of our elected officials, in matters just of the kind that have been mentioned. We don't have an obvious vehicle to do it, and it's a subject which I think we need to pursue as we move forward. But let me say that the subject of white supremacists coming into the state is not a question that can be comfortably asked a Jewish governor. We have no room for them, we have no way to live with them, and there isn't anything more to say.
Governor Greg Cifuri, I'm a member. In 1986, 40% of this body voted to close Trojan. The issue in that election was primarily nuclear waste. While nothing has happened since then to give us confidence, the only nuclear waste dump that exists for low-level waste was found a few months ago to be leaking. We have a new and more serious problem, because in the years since then, we've seen a growing scientific consensus that we live on the edge of a great earthquake. The Cascadia subduction zone off the Oregon coast has apparently given us four great earthquakes in the last 1,700 years. The last was 300 years ago.
This is a time for questions, Gregory, not
speeches.
Here's
the question.
Okay.
We have estimates from the December 17th Oregonian estimating that we have a 2-4% risk of a great earthquake in the Northwest in the next 20 years. We have a computer compilation saying It's a fairly serious matter. I'll be done very briefly.
That's all right.
He's a big boy, Charlie.
Oh, I'm not concerned about the governor. I'm concerned about the other people who'd like to ask questions, Greg. So let's...
Computer compilation of the available data on what is happening in the Northwest shows the observations fit together best only if the Northwest has periodic subduction earthquakes and that the next one is most likely to occur within 18 years. Given the fact that the Nuclear Regulatory Commission and the other governmental agencies are highly unlikely to move on such a matter, given that Trojan was designed to withstand an earthquake about 1% of the kind of earthquake that is now being predicted, do you consider the question of the continued operation of Trojan to be an open question or a closed question?
No. I do not consider it to be an open question. Yes.
Jim Stewart, I want to repeat a question that I asked of the board of well-known and very competent economists that we had last week.
Oh, thanks.
We see some... See what you can do with it. No, actually, they did well. I just want to see what you have to say.
I want Greg back.
It gets worse because you know them all. We have several measures that tell us that unemployment is down in our state and nationally, and certainly total employment is up. We have similar measures that show us that poverty rates, however, have increased. While unemployment's down, poverty rates have increased. That implies, of course, an increasing number of working poor. What can we do on the state level?
Well, we need to take a look, kind of a tough look at what's happening to us in this regard, because it's tempting sometimes to think that what's happening to us is unique in Oregon. I will say two things, the first of which I believe to be fact, and the second one is obviously just maybe unsupported but or supported conjecture on my part. The first one is that the average person in the state of Oregon earns more than $1,000 less than the national average. The ratcheting down effect of that can be seen in all kinds of ways, but essentially what it means is that the state has been less and less capable of providing working family wages for people who are entering the economy. The second point I want to make is that I think it's happening to the whole nation, and the only thing that's really hiding it is that you have to go in and look in the states that look hot and strip out their defense expenditures. And if you take out those expenditures, if you rip them out of Los Angeles Basin, if you take them out of Massachusetts, and you see the enormous infrastructure and dollar value jobs that those things are supporting, the rest of the country starts looking awfully much the same. Yes, there's a difference in the Midwest and the Northeast and automobiles and non-automobiles, but we've all got something that's working right, including here. So what do we do about it? I think the first thing we have to recognize is that we've always believed that a high-quality education was going to produce a lot of income. Well, you have a high-quality education in this state. The SAT scores for your graduating high school seniors are now second in the United States for the last few years, and number one that was ahead of us in New England is loaded up with private school kids. The kids are performing coming out of here. They are testing out number one in military test scores, and if that's the case, where is the translation to real earned income? The community college system here is one of the best resources of its kind in the world. Forget competing in the United States. You can't find a system in which the citizens have bought into it more than people have bought into their local community colleges. They are beating our doors down in Salem to open more of them. And for whatever I may say that we do not have in our universities, it is accessible to our students, and the quality, given the resources they've had, is remarkable. So why are we getting poor? Well, the answer in part is that we depended for so long on the timber economy that when the impacts of world competition hit it, we really weren't very well equipped. Now skip to the end of what we do about it. I think we have to be purposeful and very, very patient about recognizing that nothing is going to come to us unless we work very hard for it. We have advantages that we can use selling abroad. You've been hearing it ever since you moved to this state or were born here. We just haven't done very much with them. We had 85 people out of 105 people in a mission to South Korea, Taiwan, and Japan. And when a family in Cave Falls that everybody said you ought to stay home, nothing good is going to happen, gets on the plane and has their antique carriages and sleighs and stagecoaches shipped to Taiwan and Japan and sells them all, the message is that Oregon family businesses and small businesses and medium-sized businesses can compete, can sell, and they must. And we're going to build an infrastructure, not beginning with me, the legislature started it before I came, the small business assistance centers. Add to that a foreign trade marketing center in the state of Oregon that'll be opened in Portland soon. Build the Portland State Foreign Trade Institute and do the things we have to do to sell abroad. That's number one. Folks, the cost of shipping coming from the Orient here and the cost of rail going east from here is high because the imports are pounding across our docks. It's tough for us to ship products into the Midwest while they're dumping canned food processed in Michigan, in LA, because they're repositioning rail cars to pick up the next round of imports that are coming in. But the ships going the other way work for us. One, we are going to be an export culture. That means language, it means training, it means education, and it means basically government can't do it. The business community is going to do it. Second, we have huge advantages. Low-cost power is still an enormous advantage. And this timber base, which is so controversial, is an unending asset if you think about exactly where we are. We have private timber 10 to 15 years away from coming back on second and third growth. All of the debate today is about the 80% of the wood product that we're now cutting, which is on federal land. Only 20% of it is on private land. Some of the best land we've got is privately owned. The key is to recognize that productivity that had a mill in Springfield, Oregon when I was a kid in 1950 had 1,000 employees. Today, Seneca Sawmill in Eugene cuts double the board footage with 165 or 70 people. We have to get secondary and tertiary processing out of the wood, and we have to stop selling logs off of state land as if it made no difference. Third, do you remember what it was like when we had wigwam burners? We burned all the sawdust. We had it in our basement. We had a sawdust furnace. And then came Presto logs, and we said, oh, gee, remember? Because the air quality people said, and they should have, we all said, that's enough of that. We're not going to have that pollution. So along came Presto logs. What we burned, basically kind of as junk, turned out to be an incredible resource. Well, a third of the chips in this state are still going overseas so somebody can make pulp and paper someplace else. These are all opportunities on the natural resource base. Final point, I want to come back to education. The reason we made such a big deal, Mark Hatfield and Les Aucoin, who really did the yeoman's work on this thing, about the opening of an advanced institute for computer technology, cited at the Graduate Center, but it is in fact a joint venture between the Graduate Center and the state system of higher education, in which we are committed to raising $15 million in private resources. 10 of it has already been committed, essentially. The reason we made a big deal out of it is that in parallel processing technology, Oregon is actually at the cutting edge of the world today, not because of its academic institutions, but because of 4 or 5 private companies that are here. We can be at the front of the line after we began to make this move, and we're in the process of preparing it. And after Les and Mark got $5 million out of the federal government, IBM finally announced publicly what everybody has been waiting for. They have decided this technology is for real, and they are going to start investing in it massively. But it's here. We have 4 companies, Sequent, N-Cube, Floating Points, Intel, tremendous world competitors. We have to start matching up the cutting edge of higher education, not just in technology, in biomedicine or medical fields. It could be in liberal arts, it can be in business, any place, with real opportunities in the marketplace. This is not a message about turning our great universities into vocational schools. It is about the fact that if it can be done at Stanford and Berkeley and have them rated as the best universities in the United States, it can be done in Oregon, and we're going to do it.
Michael Burke, City Club member.
Say your name again, I'm sorry.
Michael Burke, I'm a City Club member.
Thank you.
You mentioned child abuse earlier, and I'm wondering what specifics you have on your agenda for the prevention and dealing with the consequences of child abuse.
Well, I'm not going to talk program today because the point I want to make is that today was my way of saying to you that if I can persuade you, all of the yous that are here and listening, that there is a children's agenda for this state to be built, you can build it. And I'll try to do what I can to make it happen in the government. We went to the legislature last time, and I think part of the reason people feel so good about this state today is you got an unbelievable performance out of those people. Day one, January 12th, and all the way to sine die when they went home, they cranked out incredible work. We have never taken a complete agenda for children. I'm not sure we can get it done by then, but I think we can, to into this organization and say to them, committee by committee, revenue committee, if they have a piece of it, education committee will have a piece, human resources will have a piece, but the document has to be integrated. We did it last time in economic development. We took the front end of what is going to be an integrated crime and corrections and prevention strategy in, but this part really never arrived except for a couple of pieces we just felt we couldn't wait on, like the student retention initiative and a civil commitment bill and some other things. So my comment to you is, get ready. I mean, we're going to provide a vehicle for you to help us do it. I don't know enough about the subject to say that I know the choices are right. But we have learned one thing in this last year and a half, and I'm talking about from the elections and the transition till today, and that is where local communities, the citizens and the individual groups that are there, buy into an agenda, it happens. And where they don't, it doesn't. And that's what we're going to have. This is not going to be a state program. We're going to try to create a vehicle for people to create children's agendas at local or regional levels. We'll be the best partners we can be. Yes?
Dave Olson's my name, member of the City Club. I feel like following up to what you just said about how the community can do these things if the governor and the state provide the leadership. As an example, we have a group called the Northwest Foundation for Children that's been requested to produce a video film to train foster parents out in eastern Oregon in these places where they can't come in to Portland. And we were requested to do that by the Children's Service Division. And it's amazing what can happen when the request is put out there. You find private money. I wanted to mention a bill that Senator Dodd has introduced on he calls it the Young Americans Act. Claude Pepper co-introduced it in the House. I think after that great speech you gave on children, you could help shape this bill. And I want to thank you very much for your emphasis on children.
Well, give me a copy of it.
I will.
I leave. Thank you very much. Oh, I can't call on this man. yes, sir, my time on trains, planes, it's all over now.
Well, I guess I need no introduction, right? Governor Goldschmidt, you
this
mentioned
the problem. This is Ray Polani, member of the City Club. I hope he's still...
Yes, yes. Thank you, Governor. Governor Goldschmidt, you indicated the problems of railroads in the state and nationally. What about putting together a rail system within the state open to private operation? Not unlike the highway network.
You talking about for passengers?
No, for freight
for
and
freight.
Passengers.
Okay. Well, we're entering a very interesting time. This is an area that I spent a lot of time at when I worked on the Staggers Act, which we thought deregulated railroads. But as I think you can see from the sort of the vacillating back and forth of the Interstate Commerce Commission and the Justice Department in this Reagan administration, they allowed the MOPAC Union Pacific end-to-end merger and turned around and dumped on the Southern Pacific's attempt with the Santa Fe. And we are really in jeopardy. We have been seeing, and we knew we were going to get some abandonment. You've seen the folks up in Hood River move to take advantage, turn lemons into lemonade, as it were, on a line that runs down to the UP main line alongside I-84. And there have been some other success stories, but truthfully, we're not quite sure what the ICC is up to. We have a proposal from the Burlington Northern, or we had one, I should say, to turn over to a private, another business, one of their lines that runs from Eugene up to Portland and another leg that runs from Astoria up here. Our goal is to maintain service, and our goal is to try to make the system flexible enough to attract people who want to provide it. Whether we're going to be encouraged to do that by the Interstate Commerce Commission, whether the way the railroads are going to deal with their labor issues, and I mean, are they going to deal with them fairly, because sometimes they just have not, they've just basically stomped on the workers, is going to decide a lot about whether we can be a player. Right now, what we are trying to do is assemble a shippers group, or a users group, maybe would be a better way to say it, of which the state would be a participant. That is, the PUC, Economic Development, and the Department of Transportation would purchase a membership and sit at the table with other Oregon users. We think that the Kansas City Southern and the Denver Rio Grande proposals to buy the Southern Pacific are big issues for us. We think what Burlington Northern is doing is important. We have just concluded a meeting with the president and chairman of the board of Burlington to express our views directly, and have communicated similar views to other railroads. So I guess I would say there'll be, I hope, a group working at this that will give people who are interested a chance to say that you're not doing it right, or there's something else more you can do. I'm too far away from it technically, but I must say, if somebody said, what's the major threat to the economy of this state, particularly from Eugene south, it's the Southern Pacific situation today.
Larry Griffith, City Club member. I brought as my guest today the chairman of the board of the David Douglas School District, who just happens to be my son. I'm sure that he is very glad to hear those nice words of yours about education. The other day, I was listening to a talk given by some East County educators, not of the David Douglas District, about the fact that they project that the educational requirements by the year 2000 that 83% of the jobs that will be available will not require a college-degreed person. That precludes, of course, then that only 17% of the high school graduates would require a college degree. So that immediately shows that the emphasis is going into technical training educational processes between the high school and the community colleges. And I was just wondering if you thought perhaps that this figure has any realism in it, and if it does, what kind of an impact would such an educational process have upon higher ed budgets?
Well, I have no way to verify the figure, and I don't presume to say that it's accurate or not. I do think that our system is a peculiarly unable to adjust to those things except by having each of the groups come individually and say, we need more money. If the universities or colleges don't see a drop in enrollment coming, they market the dickens out of what they have to sell, because the individual institutions don't think it's in their interest to get smaller and have any money taken away. The community colleges have done the same thing. There are a whole set of proposals, 2+2 and other things, trying to link junior and senior year high school curriculum into community colleges, and trying to link community college curriculums, standards, and transferability to the universities. You can see how well it is working by having a situation in which the Board of Higher Education has concluded, for what they think are very important economic reasons, that they need a semester system, and the entire community college system is essentially trailing along behind with only part of their student body transferring. They have a whole other mission here that you're talking about, and they're not really in the loop. It's been tried to be addressed with the Educational Coordinating Commission. I think in frustration, the legislature has concluded that isn't cutting it. We have started our own executive office of education that Paul Bragdon will lead beginning in July, in no small part because I don't think the governors in this state, with 50% of the money that is spent out of the Oregon state budget going to education, have known very much about what's happening with it, and have really tried very hard, because they haven't been able to in many cases, to get ahead of these issues to make decisions. So I can't comment on the specifics of that. I did say what I wanted to say in this speech today about the importance of education without trying to define where it came from. If Japanese kids are going to school 60 days a year more than ours, and by the time we get a kid to the 12th grade, they have equivalent of a Japanese ninth grade education, and only 70% of the kindergarten kids who are in that 12th grade, of the 100% who started in kindergarten, only 70% graduate, you start seeing the consequences of spending over and over and over again for the same kid. Forget excellence. I'm just talking about getting them out of a school. And the ones that aren't coming out, we've got all over the place in other kinds of social payments. We'd be much better off using resources like the community colleges and elementary and secondary school, and if necessary, buying services from private educators to get these kids the education they need. I think for all of us, the linkages between the business community, the individual employer, and the workforce idea is a hard one to make, but we're going to have to work harder to make it. Yes?
Terry Chadwick, City Club member. You have talked about the importance of children, the importance of education, and the economy. Nowhere did I hear him mention health care. There's been a lot in the paper lately about trade-offs between transplants and pregnant women. What steps are you planning to take to ensure a statewide health plan to make sure that every citizen in this state has a basic level of health care?
We are about to announce the members of a citizens group that is going to go to work on the subject you raise. But I can almost promise you to start with that its recommendation will not be the beginning of a comprehensive health care program on day one. The costs are very high and have to be found somewhere. So the question is, if you wanted to put the building blocks in place and build toward that system, how would you do it? And I think that's where we have to start. It's very important in the context of the transplant issue to look at what it is that this issue means to us, because you've raised it, I think, in the right way. The problem that the state government is wrestling with transplants is that the entire medical system in this country is spending most of its money on the far end of the system. That is, when it's probably in some cases too late, but if it isn't too late, it's very expensive. The legislature took a small step last time in paying for prenatal care to saying, you know, the cost of not doing this is that these people end up carrying children to term who are born sick and in other ways ultimately over their lives unable to learn or whatever, and they will be dependent. I thought it was a very intelligent decision. It wasn't meant to be a trade-off with transplants. The transplant issue totally uncovers for us the dilemma. Because what we've got with the transplant issue is not an issue of who's eligible for transplants that gets welfare. It's who gets transplants, and it's everybody who isn't able to have health insurance. They are employed. They do have jobs. They are not entitled to welfare, but they don't have insurance. It isn't provided on their job. Their incomes don't allow them to buy it with the amount of money that they earn. And as a consequence, they are lined up in hospitals at the end of the medical circumstance that they're dealing with instead of the beginning, with unpaid medical bills in hospitals all over the state and in the communities that are hardest hit economically, and that's not Portland. In small communities with community hospitals dependent on natural resource bases, we are facing closure of hospitals for this and many other reasons. This country needs a medical care system. Whether the states can do it is a really interesting question. We're not left with much of a choice given what the federal government is doing, but to do what we're going to try to do. But the most aggressive effort that got the closest to achieving a victory in the legislature in the United States, led by Governor Dukakis in Massachusetts, finally even the legislature in Massachusetts stopped and said, I don't think we can pass this without going back to rethink it because the bill may be too large. So, we are going to go look at it, and we're going to see what we can do to put in place the basics. The interesting thing is that the first foundation here may be a program that doesn't provide any transplants at all. What it provides is access to an individual or a family to basic medical services that allow them to get preventative treatment for the things that all of us, I think, would expect to get. It's a miserable issue in a nation in which health care costs are running at 10 and 11 and 12% inflation rate when the rest of the country's rates are low, and a state government that can barely pay its bills is trying to chase that down the road and figure out how to get people the medical services they need. It's not very comfortable, but I don't see that we have a choice, and we are going to go after it, and I don't know how soon you'll have something to look at, but it's coming rotating up on the agenda pretty quick. Yes?
Olive Barton, City Club member. What question would you ask the presidential candidates, and what response would you hope to hear?
Olive, I would ask basically this question. I got to be careful I don't do a Greg Furey and make the run-up so long, but basically it would do this. I believe that three things must be done for this country to be back on the road to sustaining itself as the most powerful nation in the world. One, we have to correct this serious problem of exports. Two, we have got to balance the budget. And three, it will have to be achieved by a very substantial bipartisan effort of the best talent in the United States of both parties coming to the flag to do it. Tell me why you can do it, and tell me how. And best of all, come to Oregon and do it.
Governor Sarah Harlan, member of the club. I have that same question for you for the candidates for mayor for Portland.
Sarah, you should ask it. I don't think I ought to be asking any questions. If I were living here and voting here, I might even be tempted to answer the question, but I'm now getting a chance to vote in the mayor's race in Salem, about which we have one. I do want to say, because it's an interesting situation where, for me personally, all four of these candidates are people that I know, some better than others. I probably know Ron Still the least, although he was in the police bureau. I know Jim Davis very well because he was Bruce Baker's right-hand man when Bruce was chief. I've gotten to know Bud Clark over a long period of time. He not only worked in my campaigns and did all of the things everybody's familiar with, but I've had a chance to work with him as mayor. And obviously I served with Lloyd Anderson as a city commissioner and later in the, during his time at the port. There is something that we really must be careful about, and that is that we are making crime the issue it ought to be, and not thinking about what we are going to have to do to fix it. I hope to say a lot more about this subject. It was a very tough decision for us about whether to come here and talk about crime, but I think the message wouldn't have been understood the way it needs to be. When somebody says, whose fault is it that the situation is the way it is, raise your hand. That's just about where we are. The bunch of us, collectively, have allowed the criminal justice processes of this state to deteriorate to the point where no one who is likely to be a serious violator believes there is any sanction left in the system. Bud Clark didn't create it. Jim Davis and Ron Still didn't by neglect as police officers create it. And certainly Lloyd Anderson couldn't be assigned the responsibility for when he was a commissioner or a port member any more than I could. And I think I get a lot. And I guess the point I want to make to people in this city club, who I came to speak to about the state of the city more than once, that the state of this city will be fine as long as we recognize that this crime problem, it has a series of fundamentals that include employment. And frankly, if you look at the effort the business community made in 1968 after the riots in Albina, that effort isn't present today to hire kids that don't have jobs. If you look at the situation we're facing in terms of mental health program, the state deinstitutionalized most of the mentally ill and stripped the children's programs. There's almost nothing left. And you have to be careful not to dump the consequences of a lot of things that all of us didn't do, including state government, into this race, and then narrow the decision down so far that when you're done, you really had no basis for a decision. That's not advice about who to support, and maybe it isn't even proper to say what I've said, but you are actually blessed that you've got some quite capable people who are in this race. That's not a bad situation. You have a mayor who is, I think, is prepared to run on his record and should. I think it's a healthy situation. He's done some things with the convention center and other things that, you know, I think anybody would stand up and be proud of. And I could say the same thing about Lloyd and Jim in particular. But please, the strategy that built this community back from school closures, terrible racial problems, housing abandonment, real estate redlining, all the other things, wasn't a strategy basically which focused on one issue. And I hope that as this campaign goes forward, and I hope as governor I can help in this debate to give you some choices to work with, not just the candidates, but you personally, that will give you some sense of confidence. We're getting the message about this crime issue, and we're going to address it in its real proportions. Thank you, everybody.
This is it. This is an exciting time to live in Oregon and an optimistic time, thanks in large measure to the tone and the example set by this man. We're grateful to him. We thank you for coming today, Governor. I thank all of you for coming, and we are adjourned.